So my text verse is actually going to be in verse number 32, but the context actually picks up, there we see your paragraph marker about halfway through the chapter in verse number 20, where he says, "My son, keep thy father's commandment and forsake not the law of thy mother." Verse 21, "Bind them continually upon thine heart and tie them about thy neck. When thou goest, it shall lead thee. When thou sleepest, it shall keep thee. When thou awakest, it shall talk with thee." Then he says, verse 23, "For," that's a conjunction, "for the commandment is a lamp, and the law is light, and reproofs of instruction are the way of life." So we have a continuation, we have a colon there. Then watch what he says in verse number 24, "to keep thee from the evil woman, from the flattery of the tongue of a strange woman." When it says a strange woman, it's not talking about a weird woman. It's talking about a foreign woman. It's speaking to a man that is married. Although it says, you know, "my son," that's coming from the father. That's coming from instructions from a father and from a mother, like it was entitled. But it's speaking to a married man. And it says, "to keep thee from the evil woman, from the flattery of the tongue of a strange woman." Strange as in foreign, not your wife. "Lust not after her beauty in thine heart, neither let her take thee with her eyelids. For by means of a whorish woman, a man is brought to a piece of bread, and the adulteress will hunt for the precious life. Can a man take fire in his bosom and his clothes not be burned? Can one go upon hot coals and his feet not be burned? So he that goeth in to his neighbor's wife, whosoever toucheth her, shall not be innocent." If you skip down, we'll pick back up, as I said, in verse number 32. "But whoso committeth adultery with a woman lacketh understanding. He that doeth it destroyeth his own soul." So notice there's a very strong warning given to those that would commit adultery. And specifically, I want to focus on the admonition in verse number 32. And the title of my sermon is, "Whoso committeth adultery." Whoso committeth adultery. Now, anyone who's read through the Bible one time knows that adultery is a major sin.
Right.
It's a very serious transgression. And these are very serious words. "Whoso committeth adultery." He's giving you a warning. Now, we live in an age of just so much confusion. And people today, you know, they try to you know, blur the lines of every definition. And they try to make everything confusing, you know, of what adultery is and what fornication is. And they have all these exceptions of when adultery is permissible and then when fornication is permissible. But the Bible's not confusing. The Bible's very clear of when someone is committing adultery. I'm going to go ahead and have you turn, though, real quick to Ezekiel chapter 16, verse 32. Now, the purpose of my sermon this morning is mainly to redefine the word adultery with the Bible. I want you to walk away today from the sermon. I want you to understand very clearly what the word adultery means. And the reason why that's so important is because it is such a serious sin. It is such a severe sin. Now, you know, there's weird ideas out there that all sin is equal. That's not what the Bible teaches. If you get your morality from the Bible, that's not what the Bible teaches. You know, when Jesus was brought to Pilate, you know, he told Pilate, speaking about the Jews, that those that have committed me unto thee have committed the greater sin.
Right.
Greater is a superlative. That's what part of speech that is. A superlative expresses a degree of two things. Proving, right there with just one verse out of God's mouth himself, that all sin is not equal. That the Jews had committed a greater sin, a worse sin, than Pilate had, than the Roman soldiers had. Not only that, when Aaron came down, Moses came down from the mountain, when he came to Aaron, and the people, like the Bible says, rose up to play, they had the idol, they committed fornication, Moses said unto Aaron, "What did these people unto thee that thou hast brought so great a sin upon them?" This is all throughout the Bible, all the way back to Exodus. You have Jesus saying it in the New Testament. When you read in the law, the Levitical law, it's very clear that, you know, if you steal, that's a different punishment, a much more minor punishment than if you committed adultery. If you were to go and you were to, you know, if you have an animal, you know, even. And just as far as like civility goes, if you had an animal, you had a farm, and one of your and your animal, you know, hurt someone else's animal or hurt a person, there's a different punishment for that than there is for murder. You know, there's different degrees of sin. There's all different sorts of degrees of sin. And adultery is a major sin. And that's why it's so important to make sure that you don't lose sight of definitions. Because today, you know, we have so many people living in adultery today. That's why there's so many exceptions that have been made. The common, you know, all if you think in your mind of all the common exceptions, isn't it kind of a coincidence that that's the same exact exceptions that the world makes every time they make a choice when they want to get a divorce? Now, if you're guilty of this, if this has, you know, occurred in your past, which I don't know of anyone that it has in this room, I'm not speaking to anyone specifically, but if you're guilty of this sin, obviously you can move past this. But you need to face the facts. You need to come to the Bible with a sincere mind and say, hey, what I've committed is not a minor sin. It's not like I stole a pencil. You know, it's not like, you know, I hurt someone's feelings with wrong words. What you did was a very serious sin. And that's the purpose of my sermon, as I said. I want everyone to walk away from this room today. I want everyone to walk away from this church service. And I want you to understand the Bible's definition about how serious of a sin that adultery actually is. So I had you turn to Ezekiel chapter number 16, verse number 32. So like I said, the first thing we're going to do here we're going to get a definition of what adultery is. And we're going to start out very, very simple. Ezekiel chapter number 16, verse number 32. Michaela, hand me that water right there. It says, "But as a wife that committeth adultery, which taketh strangers instead of her husband." So it gives you a clear definition. It says, as a wife that committeth adultery, and then it tells you very clearly what she did to commit adultery, which taketh strangers, just as we saw before the word strangers, talking about a foreigner, someone that she's not married to, which taketh strangers instead of her husband. Now turn to Mark chapter 10, verse 11. So that there is a definition that almost no one would disagree with. You know, almost not a single person, a heathen, Catholic, doesn't really even matter what denomination you're of. Doesn't even really matter if you're of a, you know, a religion of, if you're even of Christianity. Almost everyone has some sort of standards as far as marriage goes. You know, and divorce and remarriage. And almost no one in this world would disagree with what that verse just said. That if two people have married, they said vows to one another, they're committed to one another, they're married, husband and wife. And if that wife, during that marriage, would step outside of that marriage and be intimate or have a sensual relationship with another person, that would be committed adultery. That person would be guilty of adultery. Look here at Mark chapter number 10, verse number 11. Actually, let's pick up in verse number 6. "But from the beginning of the creation, God made them male and female. For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife, and they twain shall be one flesh. So then they are no more twain, but one flesh. What therefore God hath joined together, let not man put asunder." And in the house, his disciples asked him again of the same matter. So he's talking about the same thing. That's why I wanted to read more of the context. "And he saith unto them, Whosoever shall put away his wife and marry another committeth adultery against her." Verse 12. "And if a woman shall put away her husband," that's talking about divorcing, "shall put away her husband and be married to another, she committeth adultery." So the very first definition of adultery that we got was that while two people are married, right? You know, and that definition is not the same as this definition specifically. And there are technicalities here. The first definition was two people are married to one another. They're living together. And one person, you know, secretly, if you will, often people, they always want to play it down. They use words like an affair. That's the type of word that someone would use today. They step out on their spouse without their spouse knowing, usually. That's how it would take place in today's world. They step out on their spouse and they have an intimate relationship with another person, normally without their spouse's knowledge. Now here we have Jesus saying in verse 11, "And he saith unto them, whosoever shall put away his wife," he's saying if you divorce your wife and marry another, he says, committeth adultery against her. And then he says, and if a woman, so this doesn't just go one way. It's for the man and it's for the woman. It's given to both of us. If a woman shall put away her husband and be married to another, she committeth adultery. Now, one thing I want to point out about this verse before we go any further, no exceptions are mentioned here. There are zero exceptions. And that's how this, to be frank, I mean, there is an exception, but it's like 0.001% of the time that it will occur. So let me just say this statement before we go any further. Once you are married, there are zero exceptions for divorce. Period. Now, I don't care your situation. And here, let me explain this to you. This is, I think this right here would clear up a lot of the confusion. When you take that vow with your spouse that we are going to be together for the rest of our life, that I'm promising that I'm not going to leave you nor forsake you, there's nothing you can do to take that vow away. Now, it doesn't matter if you go make that vow with another person. That's the point of this passage. Even if you stand up behind the altar with another person, even if you fill out some sort of bill of divorcement or paperwork, it is not a legit divorce and that vow still stands. And it's the exact same way of committing adultery is if you secretly went out with another person and just slept with another person. You were sensual with another person on the weekend. There's no difference at all, period. You and your wife can even consent to one another and say, hey, you know, we're not getting along. Are you getting along with me? No, things aren't working out. Okay, let's divorce. You can get a divorce. But if you go and you put your wife away and you go, you know, even say vows and then you're sensual with another person, you have committed adultery.
Right.
Period. There is no gray area. And like I said, you know, we live in a very confusing time where there's 15 exceptions. Amongst Christians, they'll give you 3 or 4 reasons why you can, you know, why you can commit adultery, basically, but how you can get remarried. Divorce and remarriage. The Bible's clear. The Bible is very clear. Once you say those vows, that's why it's so important. That's why the subject in defining these terms is so important in such a confusing time. Because when our children stand up behind the altar, you know, in front of an altar, you know, a fake altar, obviously, but they stand there and they're getting ready to say vows to one another, right? That is very serious, and they both need to be, and they need to understand the definition of adultery. They need to understand, you know, the definition of marriage and what God considers marriage, and when the only situation of when it is permissible, which we'll get to in a minute, is so rare that it never even occurs. So you know what that means? You know, whether you like it or not, you're stuck with your spouse for the rest of your life.
Amen.
You know, and you need to make your mind up before obviously you take that next step. And people wouldn't so flippantly, you know, just stand up and make a vow to one another of hey, and not really mean it. And we live in a day of just where people are just insincere in the first place. That's why the divorce rate is like 40-50% of people in America have been divorced. That's insane. That's crazy. And you know what else is crazy? There is zero variance with Christians. The exact same rates apply to Christians. Doesn't matter what denomination you are either. You can be an independent Baptist. You can be, you know, a Catholic. It doesn't matter. Christians in every denomination, in every way, are divorcing their spouses at the exact same rate as non-believers. People of other religions. It's insane. And I guarantee that if every church, whether saved or unsaved, you know, Presbyterian or whatever, if they started preaching just as a test experiment, if they started preaching behind the pulpit, if they started telling their congregation, hey, the real definition of what the Bible teaches, you know, adultery is, and even Catholics used to have this right. Even Presbyterians used to have this right. And you know what the effect was throughout the nation? People weren't getting divorced at a 40-50% rate. And you know what happens? Like that first verse that it said, you destroy your own soul. That was the first verse we read. It said, whoso committeth adultery, it said that he destroys his soul. And that's what people are doing. They're destroying their souls. They're destroying their lives. Go to, let's look at another definition. Let's look at Luke chapter number 16, verse number 18. Luke chapter number 16, verse number 18. So there's different aspects to when a person can commit adultery. There's different scenarios, obviously. So the first thing we saw was just a person just stepping out on their spouse. You know, they're just secretly going behind their spouse's back and having a sensual relationship or being intimate with another person. The other situation we had was where, you know, even in a situation where two people consent to one another, hey, we're going to get a divorce. And if you go, both of you go, and you both get remarried, you've committed adultery. That's what the Bible teaches. Look at Luke chapter number 16, verse number 18. It says in Luke chapter number 16, verse number 18, whosoever putteth away his wife and marrieth another committeth adultery. Now watch this. And whosoever marrieth her that is put away from her husband committeth adultery. Now, here we get another angle there down at the bottom. So even if you yourself have never been married in your entire life, right? Even if you don't fall into the first category, you were married and you stepped out of your wife, or you divorced your wife and you got remarried, you know, to another woman. Even if you don't fall into either one of those categories and you've never said a vow to a person in your life, if you, man or woman, it doesn't matter either way. If you are intimate with another person, whether, and really here, it doesn't even matter. He says, and whosoever marrieth her that is put away, her husband committeth adultery. If you were to marry that person that was put away, let's say like we had the scenario before, two people consent, even if they consent to it, even if husband and wife consent to it, they both leave one another, and you're just a single guy, and you approach under that woman that was divorced by her, but obviously they committed adultery. But you know what you've done? You've just now entered in into their sin. You've just now basically just entered yourself into. You've taken upon their adultery. You've just included yourself into their adulterous relationship is what you've done. Because their vow still stands. And it's just as wicked for you. So don't, you know, people always want to try to play down these other things. They always want to try to, just like how they just changed the entire definition of the word adultery. Well, if you're not happy, you know, then I believe that's an exception. You know, just like those situations, it doesn't matter whether you personally, you know, were going behind someone's back or if that guy put his wife away, but every single definition of adultery is still adultery, and they're all wicked as hell. Every single one of them are super wicked. And we're going to look at it real quick because we want to get an idea of how bad adultery is. Because my purpose of the sermon today, if there's somebody that maybe is tempted with this, and you know, maybe if somebody's done it in the past, my purpose is so that you never do it again, number one. And maybe if somebody ends up being tempted in the future, maybe, you know, we all have problems in our relationships. I mean, no one can act like, you know, I just have the best relationship. You know, me and my husband and my, my wife, I mean, me and my wife, we just get along great. We never fought the whole 20 years that we've been married. That's ridiculous. Nobody's relationship is like that. No one on this planet that's ever lived. So, when we have problems like that, if we lived in in a country where we grew up that adultery is fine, you know what most people would do? And that's what's being taught in the United States. So my purpose, my other purpose for this sermon this morning is that people that have never committed adultery will never commit adultery. They realize like, man, this is serious stuff. Man, I'm going to destroy my own soul. Man, there's a serious punishment for this. Go to, have you turn to another passage here. Go to Jeremiah chapter number 23, verse number 14. So I'm going to look at all of the I'll call them misconceptions, but the arguments against, you know, and all the supposed exceptions that people will use. But we're going to look at Jeremiah chapter number 23, verse number 14. And we're going to get an idea of just how bad adultery is from God, from God's mouth. Jeremiah chapter number 23, verse number 14. Look at Jeremiah chapter number 23. Verse number 14, he says, I have seen also in the prophets of Jerusalem, watch what he says, an horrible thing. They commit adultery and walk in lies. They strengthen also the hands of evildoers, that none doth return from his wickedness. They are all of them unto me as Sodom, and the inhabitants thereof as Gomorrah. Now, this particular passage is not referring to, you know, the physical act of two people actually committing adultery. He's actually referring to, in this passage, you know, when because he considers himself married unto Jerusalem. And we're going to go to one of the exceptions and misconceptions with that passage in a minute. But he considers himself figuratively married unto Jerusalem, married unto the people of Israel, right? And he'll say if they go whoring after other gods, he'll say they've committed adultery against it. But here, either way, it doesn't matter. Here's the thing. When he says that they committed adultery, he says that it's a horrible thing. And if you say, well, yeah, so he's not even, they're not even talking about the physical act here, so obviously that's not a horrible thing. I mean, you're missing the point here. When they commit a major sin, when they forsake God, it's so bad that he says it's like they committed adultery. So even if this isn't the physical act of adultery, when he wants to liken them forsaking him, he says that they've committed adultery, and then he says they've committed a horrible thing. So whether it's figurative or not, it doesn't make a difference. He defines adultery as a horrible thing. Look at, go to Leviticus chapter 20, verse 10. Leviticus chapter 20, verse 10. I'll read these other ones to you. So I'm just going to read some of the commands from God himself against adultery. Exodus chapter 20, verse 14, where you'll find the Ten Commandments. He says, thou shalt not commit adultery. Then when the commandments are reiterated in the book of Deuteronomy, he says in Deuteronomy chapter 5, verse 18, neither shalt thou commit adultery. Then we have Jesus speaking and quoting the Old Testament in Matthew chapter 5, verse 27. Just clear commandments. Ye have heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not commit adultery. Now I read those for this reason. That means something different to a lot of people across the nation today. Because these terms have been changed and they've been twisted so badly of what the actual definition of the word adultery is. Most people would only consider adultery if a person stepped out in the relationship when they were married. And they were still living in the same household together. And they were considered on good grounds with one another. There's a lot of people that would consider that the only case of adultery. And then if it was a consensual situation of when they divorced one another, that was no longer considered adultery. Now, that's why this right here, just where God plainly says, thou shalt not commit adultery. When you understand all the confusion behind the term, it kind of gives you the perspective of why it's so important to make sure that you understand what the word adultery actually means. Now, Mark chapter 10, verse 19, again, he says, thou knowest the commandments, do not commit adultery, do not kill, do not steal, and he goes on and on. Galatians chapter 5, verse 19, he says, now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these, adultery, fornication, uncleanliness, lasciviousness. So you're in Leviticus chapter number 20, verse number 10. Bible says in Leviticus chapter number 20, verse number 10, excuse me, and the man that committeth adultery with another man's wife, even he that committeth adultery with his neighbor's wife. Now watch this. The adulterer and the adulteress shall surely be put to death. And the man that committeth adultery with another man's wife, even he that committeth adultery with his neighbor's wife, the adulterer and the adulteress shall surely be put to death. I read it twice to let it set in, because I want you to understand the severity. You know, before, because people make this decision all the time. And here's the thing, let it sink into your mind right now that 40 to 50% of the people in this nation, God's commandments, he doesn't feel differently about adultery today, folks. That 40 to 50% of the people that live in this country today, God, if he was running the country, if his government was instituted, he would put them to death. That's a fact. He wouldn't just do something different. He wouldn't just give amnesty to every person walking around in this nation. Do you know what God would do? Let that sink into your mind. If you personally chose to step out on your wife, or if you personally chose to step out on your husband, do you know what God wishes would happen to you? Do you know what God's perfect system would be? God would put you to death. You say, well, how do you know God would do that? Because the Bible says so.
Amen.
Because God inspired these words, and God, when God gave the perfect government to the children of Israel, he said, the adulterer and the adulteress, the man and the woman, Both of them, they did it. And here's the thing. The reason why we define the term first is so that you'd understand who's being discussed here. It's not just you that stepped out on your wife or your husband secretly. Do you know who else it is? The 40 to 50%. I said 40% of people are divorced. That's not even including the people that are committing adultery behind the scenes. So the 40 to 50%, that's just 40 to 50% of people right there that God says you deserve death. You don't even deserve to walk on this planet anymore. You don't even deserve to live anymore. But you know why? Because it's such a serious sin. That's why. Because it's a severe sin. Go to Jeremiah chapter number 3, verse number 8. That's why people want, and that's the whole reason why this all sin is equal garbage gets brought up. It's not brought up by the guy that did the minor sin. You know, the guy that, like, you know, is used as the example so often that stole the pencil. The guy that used bad language, he's not the one going around saying all sin's equal. He doesn't want sin to be equal. He wants it to be a minor sin. You know the people that are going around saying all sin's equal? The adulterers. Because we've got 40 to 50% of people that are adulterers. Do you know why the definition of adultery got changed? If it wasn't a common sin in America, do you expect me to believe that it would still have a different meaning today? I don't believe that for a second. The reason why the definition of adultery got changed is because our nation is filled with a bunch of adulterers. That's why. Because they don't want to say, hey, I'm worthy of death. You know, when the Bible actually says the adulterer and the adulteress shall surely be put to death, that's talking about me. That's why people don't want to say that. That's why people try to act like all sin is not equal. Because we have people committing major sins, severe sins, horrible sins, sins that will destroy their own soul. So you're in Jeremiah chapter number 3, excuse me, verse number 8. Jeremiah chapter number 3, excuse me, verse number 8. It says in Jeremiah chapter number 3, verse number 8, and I saw when for all the causes whereby backsliding Israel committed adultery, I had put her away and given her a bill of divorcement, a bill of divorce, yet her treacherous sister Judah feared not, but went and played the harlot also. The harlot also. Look at Hosea chapter number 4, verse number 13. What I want to point out about that is the strong language that God uses to speak unto the person that committed adultery. Notice he says also. So what is he saying about Judah when Judah committed adultery? That she's a harlot. You know what the word harlot means? It's not something we use all the day, but it means a whore. That's why. And you know why that word is really falling out of use a lot today? Why people act like it's so offensive? That's like one of the worst things you can call a woman today. You know, that they act just so offended about that word. Obviously, it is one of the worst things you can call a woman. But, you know, it's one of the things that everyone, if that word comes out of your mouth, it's like one of the worst cuss words now, it seems like. And it's because all the women, it's just like adultery and adulteresses. It's because a lot of the women that are walking around today are whores. That's a fact. And here's the thing. It's not one-sided. 40 to 50%, it's not just the women that got divorced. The men that are walking around today, too, are a bunch of whoremongers. You know, whoremonger is the masculine and whore is the feminine. So if you wanted to call a woman a whore, you know, wanted to call a woman by that title, it would be a whore. If you wanted to call a man by that title, it would be a whoremonger. And I think we need to start bringing back biblical words. And if I had somebody in my family and I loved them and I wanted to sit down and talk to them about a subject like this, obviously I would do it in meekness and I would do it in kindness, but I would tell them, hey, you're being like a whore right now. I mean, that should wake somebody up. You are living, you are making decisions that a whore would make. You know what a whore is? It's a prostitute. It's someone that has zero dignity, zero integrity. It's a person that would just stand on the street for money instead of just going and getting a job or working at home or doing whatever. It's a person that would stand on the street and they would take money from guy after guy or woman after woman just to be able to lay with that person, to lie with that person, as the Bible says. And the Bible says that if you're an adulterer, you're an adulteress, that you're a harlot, that you're a whore. You say, man, why are you calling me that? So that you don't ever commit adultery. That's why. So you don't go sleep around with other people. So you don't divorce. And it doesn't make you not a whore because you went through a divorce process. If you divorced your husband, I'm going to keep saying this because this definition is so obscure to people today. If you went behind your husband's back, or you went behind your wife's back and slept with another person, you're a whore, or you're a whoremonger. If you divorced your husband and you divorced your wife and you went and you slept with other people, you are a whore. You're a whoremonger. You're a harlot. It's disgusting. What you're doing is filthy. That's why it's called a whore and a whoremonger. You just go out, you know, and here's the thing. Out of the 40 and 50%, do you think all of those people just got divorced one time? Not a chance. Are you kidding me? Like, I would guarantee out of that 50%, half of it, at least 25% of those people, or at least 50% of the 50%, so 25% of the population has been divorced at least twice. At least. And that's not the only person, you know, we live in such a promiscuous society today. By the time they marry their spouse half the time, that's not the first person they'd ever been with in the first place. So they're just, you know, they've been with three people before they get married. They get married and it's just no big deal to trade that person away and go get married again and be intimate with one more person too. People don't, just when they say vows and stuff like that, it means nothing to them. And you know how hurtful it is to your spouse to step out on your spouse and to commit such a wicked, horrible, awful sin? There's like nothing worse that can be done. You know, Pastor Anderson has said this before, and I'm not just repeating it verbatim. I think every man feels the exact same way. But I don't think that there's anything worse that anyone could do to me outside of my wife committing adultery on me. You know, if you read the passage that we actually read through in Proverbs chapter 6, do you know what it brought up? Do you know why, one of the reasons why I was talking about if you destroy your own soul? Because it's talking about the guy that is married to the woman that you commit adultery with is going to kill you. And that's the exact same way that I feel. If you committed adultery with my wife, I would kill you. And I think every man feels that way. Every single man. There's stories of people all the time. It used to be more common. Today, you know, the guy's probably cheating on the wife too, so when he comes home, he doesn't care. People don't love each other anymore. They're going to trade up to another wife in 3-4 months anyways. But people that actually have integrity, it means something to them. So you need to understand how bad it would hurt you when you think about stepping out on your wife. You need to understand how bad it would hurt you when you and how serious of a sin it is and what punishment that God says you deserve. And how serious of a sin, over and over it's brought up, and the person that does it is called a harlot. The person that commits this act is called a whoremonger or a whore. Where do I have you turn, Hosea? Hosea chapter number 4, verse number 13. It says, they sacrifice upon the tops of the mountains and burn incense upon the hills, under oaks and poplars and elms, because the shadow thereof is good. Therefore your daughters shall commit whoredom, and your spouses shall commit adultery. I will not punish your daughters when they commit whoredom, nor your spouses when they commit adultery. For themselves are separated with whores, and they sacrifice with harlots. Therefore the people that doth not understand shall fall. Have you turned to another passage. Go to Isaiah chapter number 57, verse number 3. Isaiah chapter number 57, verse number 3. The strong language that God repeatedly just uses over and over again to refer to the person that has committed this act of adultery. Isaiah chapter number 57, verse number 3. It says, but draw near hither, ye sons of the sorcerers, the seed of the adulterer and the whore. Now that's talking about two different people. One thing, just for Bible knowledge, like I said before, you have the whore, that's the woman. You have the whoremonger, that's the man. You have the adulterer, that's a man. And then when the Bible says the adulteress, do you remember in the passage that we read in Leviticus chapter 20, verse 10? He said the adulterer and the adulteress. That's referring to the man and the woman. So when you see the adulterer used here, it's talking about a man that has committed adultery. And then when you see it says the whore, that's talking about the woman. That's why it makes sense when it says the seed of the adulterer and the whore. It's saying the offspring of the adulterer and the whore. Now, notice what it says there too. Ye sons of the sorcerers. That's one of the things I wanted to point out. Sorcery in the Bible is also punishable by death. I just want you to grasp the concept of what is keeping coupled together here and what's being associated with being an adulterer is being a whore, it's being a harlot. It's being, you know, right here, it's likened unto being a sorcerer. It's likened unto someone that's just forsaken God, just a heathen and a pagan. The category that it's put into. Turn to Hebrews chapter number 13. Hebrews chapter number 13. Look at Hebrews chapter number 13, verse number... I have 14, that's not right, it's verse 4. Look at... we'll just read just verse number 4. Marriage is honorable in all, and the bed undefiled, but whoremongers and adulterers God will judge. Now, the whoremonger and the adulterer there is both speaking to a man there. Now, you know what he's calling you? Because he's talking about marriage in context. Again, if a man stepped out on his wife while married to his wife, after, you know, if he divorced his wife, if he married another woman, you would be considered an adulterer. You would also be considered a whoremonger. Turn to another passage here, Isaiah chapter number 50, verse number 1. Isaiah chapter number 50, verse number 1. Isaiah chapter number 50, verse number 1. We're going to look now, we're going to get into the section real quick of the objections. Because if you go to your average Baptist church, your average non-denominational church, they're going to have a bunch of exceptions. If you were to go seek counsel, because they don't talk about adultery behind the pulpit in the first place, but if you were to go seek counsel with them, like, hey, this is the situation I'm in, what are my options? They're going to give you like three options, three exceptions, whereby you can get a divorce, whereby it's permissible for you to get a divorce and get remarried. And they would say that that's not adultery. Now, we're going to start with like the most ridiculous one. There's only like three of them. And we're going to fly through these real quick because I think they're all ridiculous, number one. It was real clear just from the beginning. When Jesus Christ just makes a plain statement, you know, that if you, that whoso puts away his wife and marries another commits adultery. He gives zero exceptions. Zero exceptions. Like I said, there is one that he mentions elsewhere, but there's a reason why it's not mentioned sometimes. There's a reason why he didn't think that it was that pertinent, that important of information for those people to have. It's because it's so rare. It's that rare of an exception that he doesn't even mention every time he preaches about it. This is God who's all-knowing, who knows what information people need, and he chose what he's going to put in the Bible in the first place. Now, this one right here is the most ridiculous one that is brought up of all of them. Isaiah chapter number 50, verse number 1 says, "Thus saith the Lord, where is the bill of your mother's divorcement whom I have put away? Or which of my creditors is it to whom I have sold you? Behold, for your iniquities have ye sold yourselves, and for your transgressions is your mother put away." And people will literally turn to this passage. It's mentioned elsewhere. It's actually mentioned in Jeremiah chapter number 3, again, where we read earlier. But people will turn to this passage, and one of their reasons why they say that adultery is all right is because they say God was divorced. And they say that God here is admitting, he's saying in verse number 1, "Thus saith the Lord, where is the bill of your mother's divorcement?" And now that is a bill of divorcement, right? "Whom I have put away. Or which of my creditors is it to whom I have sold you?" So they say, see, God got a divorce. Therefore, it's all right for me to get a divorce. That is totally idiotic. Now, here's the question. Did God literally stand up with the nation of Israel and literally make a vow of marriage? Of course not. The Bible's figurative, and the people that use this kind of stuff, they know that it's figurative. The people that want this passage to mean what they say and what they want it to mean is because they have an agenda, obviously. But the Bible's being figurative here because look at the next passage. He says, "Whom I have put away," and then he says, or I'm sorry, the second part of it, right after the bill of divorcement. He says, "Or which of my creditors is it to whom I have sold you?" So here's the thing. If you want to take the first part of that passage literal, right? Of the bill of divorcement, that God literally wrote a literal bill of divorcement and divorced the nation of Israel, then you have to tell me which creditor that God literally sold them to. Because that's what he's saying right here. You want to take both literal, you got to be consistent with your logic, my friend. Because if you want to try to justify your sin of adultery by using this passage and want to say that, you know, well, God got a divorce, that same verse, God likens it unto selling them unto a creditor. But here's the thing. It's not mysterious because he tells you, look, "Behold, For your iniquities have ye sold yourselves, and for your transgressions is your mother put away. He's talking about being sold into sin, being sold into wickedness. He's saying that that is what has taken place. It's figurative. No one in their right mind would read this. I don't even believe, you know, an unsaved person would read this and come up with that unless they had some sort of agenda. Go to 1 Corinthians chapter number 7. We'll look at another objection here. 1 Corinthians chapter number 7. Now this whole chapter is actually about, you know, fornication. It's about remarriage, you know, divorce. He says in verse 1 there too, just to get the context. Now concerning the things whereof ye wrote unto me, it is good for a man not to touch a woman. Nevertheless, to avoid fornication, let every man have his own wife, and let every woman have her own husband. Let the husband render unto the wife due benevolence, and likewise also the wife unto the husband. The wife hath not power of her own body, but the husband, and likewise also the husband hath not power of his own body, but the wife. We'll skip down to, let's skip down to verse 6. But I speak this by permission and not of commandment. So make sure that that's clear, what he just said. He's saying, I speak this by permission, that God is allowing me to write this in this letter, but this is not a commandment of God. I speak this by permission, saying permission is given unto me by God, but this is not God's commandment. Therefore, this is not something that God said. I mean, it's that plain. Look at what he says next. For I would that all men were even as I myself. It's because Paul was not married. That's what he's referring to. He stayed single his entire life. But every man hath his proper gift of God, one after this manner and another after that. Now, a gift is something that not a lot of people have, or it wouldn't be a gift. He's saying that the majority of people don't have this gift. Now, look at verse number 8. I say, therefore, to the unmarried and widows, it is good for them if they abide even as I. So those that are unmarried, that have never been married, and widows, where their spouse has died. Verse number 9, but if they cannot contain, let them marry, for it is better to marry than to burn. Burn is talking about burning in their lusts. Because he just said they can't contain, talking about can't contain their lusts. Verse number 10, and unto the married I command, yet not I, but the Lord. So this is the commandment of the Lord here. Let not the wife depart from her husband. Verse 11, but, and if she depart, let her remain unmarried, or be reconciled to her husband, and let not the husband put away his wife. Now people will look at verse number 11 where it says, but and if she depart, and say, see, it's all right to depart sometimes. Verse number 10, we obviously need to read it one more time for some people. And unto the married I command, yet not I, but the Lord. So it is a commandment of God. Yet not I, but the Lord. Let not the wife depart from her husband. Very plain, no exceptions. Let not the wife depart from her husband. But, and if she departs. So he's saying, obviously life's not perfect. If you do depart, there's obviously always a plan B. You know, it is a sin and it is never right for you to leave your husband for whatever reason. It is a sin and it's never right for you to leave your wife. Because he gives you, you know, a step B or a plan B after you've already sinned and after you've already broken that law where he says, let not the wife depart from her husband. It's like in the book of 1 John where he says, he tells them plainly, you know, that these things I write unto you, that ye sin not. But if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father. So he's saying, don't sin. But if you sin, we have an advocate with the Father. There is a plan B. We have salvation through Jesus Christ. If you sin, obviously if you're a saved person, you know, you can pray to God and God will receive, you will receive forgiveness for that. Obviously, not going to lose your salvation. You'll never lose your salvation. But as far as in this physical life, if you were to sin, you could still pray to God and maybe He would lighten the punishment. Just like with David in different times, where David received grace, David received mercy for himself, like when he committed the adulterous act with Bathsheba. But it wasn't right for him to do that. But there was mercy, there was grace that was given. Here, you know, he's saying, if you depart, this is what you should do. If you do leave your husband, here's plan B. This is the next step that you should take. But and if she depart, let her remain unmarried or be reconciled to her husband. Those are the two choices if you depart. Those are your only two options. Let her remain unmarried or be reconciled to her husband. And let not the husband put away his wife. And he said, but to the rest speak I, not the Lord. So he starts speaking again there. So now let's go over to 1 Corinthians chapter number 5. This is going to play a part this right here is going to play a part with Matthew chapter number 5 here in just a moment. And that's the most commonly brought up, the most common objection that people will bring up to say that there are other exceptions, the misunderstanding of Matthew 5. But we're going to look here in 1 Corinthians chapter number 5. It says in verse number 1, it is reported commonly that there is fornication among you, and such fornication as is not so much as named among the Gentiles, that one should have his father's wife. Right? So it's fornication. We don't really even need to read any further down in through this, but that's basically the passage that they use. And they say, they try to define the word fornication here when it says as one would have his father's wife, and that would be someone committing adultery because they had their father's wife, right? Now here's the thing. Two things for that. Number one, fornication. If you were to say that this right here is referring to a person that had committed fornication with another man's wife, if this was a fact that it did say that, this would be the only time in the entire Bible that it ever said that. This would be the only time in the entire Bible where the word fornication ever meant for a man to sleep with another man's husband or wife. Fornication is a plain definition as well. And it's when two people, you know, that are not married will sleep together. Now, here's the thing. This is the point that I want to make before I get to Matthew chapter number 5. If you remember in Leviticus chapter number 20, verse number 10, it said if a man go in into another man's wife, right? It never said whether he was married or not. That's a blanket statement. So it doesn't matter whether you're married or not. You can, if you are not married and you go in into another man's wife and you sleep with that woman, you both have committed adultery. Because you know what it refers to that person as later? The adulterer and the adulteress. So the only thing to conclude from this passage, because it would be a stupid way to interpret the Bible to say, well, this isn't clear, but it seems like it's saying that when this guy committed adultery, they committed fornication. Obviously, you're misunderstanding something. And I'll tell you a scenario where that, in this case, where it's not that the person had committed, you know, adultery when he's saying that he committed fornication. And that's obviously that. I don't believe that the father is still alive. I believe it was his stepfather. And I believe that that's why it says, you know, obviously, because the Bible gives also other clear commandments in the Levitical law where it talks about not going in unto your father's wife. Many times it talks about things like that. And this would be an example of that. But I believe the reason why it's referred to fornication here is because that he's dead. It's still not right. Because you know the reason why it tells you it's not right? Because it's your close to kin. It wouldn't matter whether it's his stepfather or not. That's the only thing that makes sense, because what doesn't make sense is for fornication to mean the same thing all throughout the Bible, adultery to mean the same thing all throughout the Bible. And then you get to 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 1, and then all of a sudden you twist the meaning of the word fornication. Now go to Matthew chapter number 5. Matthew chapter number 5, verse number 31. Now the only way that I would even budge a little bit on 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse number 1, is I would say that if two people, you know, committed that act together, and one of them's married and then one of them was not, I would say this, number one, I know for a fact from Leviticus chapter 20, verse number 10, that they both have committed adultery. But I would agree that in a sense they had committed fornication. But the Bible never titles it that. That's a fact. The Bible never says that when one person is married and another person is single and then they sleep together, there's not a single time in the entire Bible where you can find it. Obviously, they committed fornication and adultery both because those two people were not married in that sense. But I don't believe that that's what it's saying in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse number 1, because it's not consistent with the rest of the Bible. Now, here in Matthew chapter 5, we're going to end here. Matthew chapter number 5, Verse number 31 is where this is the most common objection that people will bring up to you, to say that there is one of the exceptions to being divorced and remarried. Verse number 31, it says, "And it hath been said, whosoever shall put away his wife, let him give her a writing of divorcement. But I say unto you, that whosoever shall put away his wife, saving for the cause of fornication, causeth her to commit adultery. And whosoever shall marry her that is divorced, committeth adultery." Now here's the claim. What people will look at this and read, they'll say, they'll say in verse number 32 that when it says that whosoever shall put away his wife, saving. So this is the exception. Except is what that means right there when it says saving. Except. For the cause of fornication. If you ask 90% of Baptists, 90% of Christians today, what that is talking about, they'll say you have two married people, a husband and a wife. Right? If the wife steps out on the husband or the husband steps out on the wife and sleeps with another person, well, those two people together have committed fornication. Now, and they'll say that that gives you grounds for divorce. That is not what this is talking about. And it can be proven. Keep your hand here and turn to Deuteronomy chapter number 24. It actually can be proven many ways. Number one, the easiest way to prove it is if that were the case, then the death penalty for adultery makes zero sense. Because the Bible clearly teaches that if you commit adultery, that if you sleep, if you go and you... And number one, you're just changing the definitions of the word adultery. You're just... And when you feel like it, you're just changing from fornication to adultery. Number one. Number two, like I said, the death penalty would make no sense. Because you wouldn't have to get... You wouldn't have to get a divorce. That would make zero sense. If your spouse stepped out on you, that person would have committed adultery. And we saw from Leviticus chapter number 20, verse number 10, that they were to be put to death. So the bill of divorcement wouldn't be needed. You would be then a widow and you could go and get married. So that interpretation for two reasons makes zero sense there. Number one, you just, fornication, like I said in the Bible, adultery is never used in place of fornication, and fornication is never used in place of adultery. But here where have you turned Deuteronomy?
Yes.
Deuteronomy chapter number 24. We'll see, because here's the thing, when Jesus is quoting stuff right now, you know, majority of what he's quoting is found in the Bible. Here, people think like Jesus just came and he made his own laws and stuff like that. You know, Jesus came and it says that he grew in stature and in favor with man and God. He was reading the Bible. You know, the way that Jesus was able to quote those verses in Matthew chapter number 4 is because he learned the Bible. He was reading the Bible. Everything that Jesus knew, obviously he's God, right? But everything that Jesus knew, he lived on this earth as a literal man. You can't get past that in your mind. So what he learned, you know, about God was from God's Word, just like you and I do. So the things that he's quoting, he's not just quoting stuff out of thin air. He's quoting from the Bible. The one exception of divorce and remarriage is actually mentioned in the Old Testament as well. And that's what Jesus is quoting. So here in Matthew chapter number 24, look at verse number 1. "When a man hath taken a wife and married her." So notice, these people are married. They're married. "And it come to pass that she find no favor in his eyes, because he hath found some uncleanness in her. Then let him write her a bill of divorcement, and give it in her hand, and send her out of his house." Now we're going to compare two passages here. We're going to look also at Deuteronomy chapter number 22, just a couple of pages over. Deuteronomy chapter number 22, verse number 13, because this is also spoken of here just a couple of chapters over. In Deuteronomy chapter number 24, what we just saw there, when he says uncleanness, you can study this out over and over again, it's referring to fornication. It's referring to her not being a virgin. It's referring to the time when he went in unto her after they had lied together and consummated the marriage. He found her not to be a virgin. Therefore, what had she committed before that time? Fornication. She had committed fornication, right? Just like Jesus said in Matthew chapter number 5. And what was the option then given to this man? He was allowed to put her away. He was allowed to write a bill of divorcement, just exactly like Jesus said. how everything lines up. Now look here for further proof of that in Deuteronomy chapter number 22, verse number 13. It says again, if any man take a wife and go in unto her and hate her. So notice, go in unto her, that's referring to them consummating the marriage, lying together for the first time once they're married, their honeymoon. Go in unto her and hate her. That's going to tell you why he hates her. He despises her. And give occasions of speech against her and bring up an evil name upon her and say, I took this woman and when I came to her, I found her not a maid. Now the word maid in the Bible means virgin. Again, further proof of what we just read in Deuteronomy chapter number 24, that the only exception for when a man can divorce his wife is if you are under the impression when you got married that she was a virgin. This may not mean anything to people today, because like I said, our country is in complete moral decay and in the moral dumpster. So people just don't mind, you know, they don't care whether their wife has been with many women or not today anymore. Now, you know, here in Deuteronomy chapter number 22, we have the exact same definition given that we had in Deuteronomy chapter number 24. The exact same exception. Now, if we read down in Deuteronomy chapter number 22, watch what it says, the end of it may be. When he says, you know, we'll pick that back up in the middle of verse number 14. And say, I took this woman when I came to her, I found her not a maid. Then shall the father of the damsel and her mother take and bring forth the tokens of the damsel's virginity unto the elders of the city and the gate. She's proving that she was a virgin, or trying to. And the damsel's father shall say unto the elders, I gave my daughter unto this man to wife, and he hateth her. And lo, he hath given occasion to speech against her, saying, I found not thy daughter a maid, saying she wasn't a virgin. And yet these are the tokens of my daughter's virginity. That right there defined the word maid for you as well. And they shall spread the cloth before the elders of the city, and the elders of that city shall take that man and chastise him, and they shall immerse him in 100 shekels of silver and give them unto the father of the damsel because he hath brought up an evil name upon a virgin. Notice it's because she's not a virgin. A virgin of Israel, and she shall be his wife. He may not put her away all his days. So what was he going to be allowed to do? Put her away. Just like in Deuteronomy chapter number 22. Now here is the final proof in Matthew chapter number 5, that fornication is not adultery. And this is the, you know, outside of comparing Scripture with Scripture, I believe this is the best proof that just settles it all. So go back to Matthew chapter number 5, verse number 31, one more time. We'll look at this here in Matthew chapter number 5, verse number 31. He says, it hath been said, whosoever shall put away his wife, let him give her a writing of divorcement. And then he says in verse number 32, but I say unto you, that whosoever shall put away his wife, saving for the cause of fornication, causeth her to commit adultery. And whosoever shall marry her that is divorced, committeth adultery. Now, let me make this statement one more time that I made before. The number one proof is the fact that it uses two different words here. People are just trying to mix words. They're just trying to, you know, when they feel like changing the definition of a word, when they feel like adultery meaning fornication, they make, you know, adultery mean fornication. They just swap the meanings of the words, right? Notice there's two different words here. That's just simple, right? Fornication and adultery, if they mean the same thing, then why are both the words right here, right? Now, here's the final proof that just settles it all. Look at the statement. Last time we'll read it. He says, but I say unto you, that whosoever shall put away his wife, saving for the cause of fornication. Okay? Now remember the claim. Keep this in your mind while we read it. They claim, people that use this as the exception, claim that this means adultery right now. That what she did was she went out and she slept with someone else, right? And they claim that the fornication means adultery. But the reason why that cannot be true is look at the next statement. Saving for the cause of fornication, watch what it says. Causeth her to commit adultery. Do you know what that means? Do you know what that proves? That what she did in the first place was not adultery.
Right.
There's no way. You couldn't make that statement. And it would make zero sense. It would be like saying this. You know, you could put away your wife. You know, it would be like saying this. That whosoever shall put away his wife, saving for the cause of adultery, causeth her to commit adultery. Why would it even matter whether if she's committing adultery again if she had already done it? That makes zero sense. It makes zero sense. He's saying, this is what he's saying. If your wife had slept with another man, right? Before you were married, that's the one exception. That's fornication. Now, if you outside of that, if there's no other reason for you to divorce your wife and you get a divorce, do you know what you've caused her to commit? Adultery. That's what he's saying. There's no way that those words can mean the same thing. It would be repetitive. It would be nonsensical. They make this verse, they turn and twist this verse to where it just makes zero sense. Yeah. You wouldn't be able to cause your wife to commit adultery if she had already committed adultery. It's stupid. You know what it shows? That the person that came up with this in the first place just wanted to believe that they could get a divorce. I said this was going to be the last place. We'll turn to, this is really the last place and I'm done. Malachi chapter number 2. Very last book in the Old Testament. So just one book to your left. Malachi chapter number 2. Now, this is what I want you to walk away with. Number one, I want you to understand the definition of adultery. I want you to understand the one and only exception, which, like I said, remember me making the statement that it's just so rare. It's 0.001% of the time that that's the case in our society today, where, you know, a man goes in unto his wife and he expects her to be a virgin and she's not, and then at that moment he decides to divorce her. That's what we would call as an annulment. You know, in the past history of the United States, you couldn't just flippantly get a divorce whenever you wanted. They didn't allow you. You had to have a cause. And you know what originally what the cause was? It was the same as the Bible taught. It was that you weren't allowed to divorce your wife unless you went out unto your wife after you were married and found out that she wasn't a virgin. That was the number one reason, if we go back, you know, in the history of the United States, of why you were allowed to get an annulment. If you look into the history. So, what I want you to walk away with is this. I want you to understand this. A blanket statement like Jesus made multiple times. If you for any reason leave your wife, leave your husband, if you for any reason have an intimate relationship from here on out and you're married, you have committed adultery. And I want you to keep in your mind, and I want that to ring in your mind repeatedly throughout your life as a warning, like God said, you know, like in Proverbs, like we read in Proverbs chapter number 6, that the commandment is a light, right? The command, you know, it's a light, it's the way of life. You know, to keep thee from the evil woman. You need to, you know, it needs to be your light that's guiding you, the lamp that's guiding your life. And you need to keep that in your mind of just how severe and how horrible. He said it's a horrible thing. You know, he calls it an abomination. He said it's worthy of death. We need to understand the severity of adultery. And we know we don't need to be like the world, just exchanging partners, you know, all the time. Just, you know, trading our spouse for whatever reason. You know, that's so selfish is what it is. You know, the reason why, you know what, you want to know the number one reason why people get, I'll tell you, you don't even need to look at the statistics. The number one reason why people get divorces is because they're selfish. That's why. That's why. They think they're better than their spouse. That's why. They think I can do better. That's why. Because people are stinking selfish. And we shouldn't be selfish. You know, that's not a Christian characteristic. You know, we should be humble, right? We should be putting people, you know, we should be putting others before us. That's how we should act. And, you know, we should love our wives. You know, ladies should love their husbands. Look at Malachi chapter number 2, verse number 16, and we'll end on this. For the Lord, the God of Israel, saith that he hateth putting away. That's divorce. He hateth putting away. For one covereth violence with his garment, saith the Lord of hosts. Therefore, take heed to your spirit. Watch this again. We saw this earlier. That ye deal not treacherously. We saw that earlier being used as well with, you know, with adultery, actually. So that's another proof. I didn't even think about it until just now. We saw earlier just the passage of just speaking of adultery. And it said she's an adulteress and it said she's treacherous, right? Well, here it's talking about putting away. And then it says again, treacherously, right? That's because you put away your wife, you put away your husband, you marry another, you've committed adultery. You're an adulterer. Makes perfect sense. God hates divorce. God hates adultery. You know, Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. We should strive every day. And here's the thing, you know, people, I guarantee, like I said earlier, that if you know, this was still being preached, you know, I don't even have to guarantee you, you can look at the facts of how our nation used to not have such a high rate of divorce. And at that time, Adultery was looked down upon. It was frowned upon. Churches preached against it, and you know what? Now it's accepted. Churches don't talk about it, and then the rate of adultery goes up. The problem is not with the world. They've always been heathens. They've always been pagans. We need to not be like them. We need to not look to them and just say, well, it's what everybody else is doing. We need to look to the Bible, and we need to follow the Bible's commandments and let it be our law and our light. And we need to live each day to try to make God happy. And God hates divorce, and divorce is adultery. Let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for how clear your word is, dear God. We thank you that even when people try to confuse your word and try to twist passages, that it's written in such a way that if a person approaches it and they want the truth in a particular verse, they can always find it, they can always understand it, dear Lord God, they can always walk away with the truth. We ask you that you would just let those words, you know, whoso committeth adultery, just stick in our mind so we know that that's a strong admonition or a strong warning against those that would commit adultery. Help us to not blur the definitions of words, not blur, you know, terms in our mind, but to understand and to use your word as our rule of thumb of what adultery means and what every word means, and get all of our definitions and our beliefs from your word. We love you. Just be with us the rest of the day. Bless the rest of the services. In Jesus Christ's name, amen.